I'm Charlotte Rettinger. It's November 16th, 1995, conducting an interview with survivor Nahama Schneerson in Flushing, New York. What I'd like to do to begin the interview is to have you tell us about your early family life. And if you begin by telling us about your parents and so forth.
Well, I don't know where to start, but as far as I remember, age of 4, 5, 6, in that age, that I had a wonderful mother and father, Yaakov, my father, Etel, my mother's name. At this point, I had already two older sisters, and Zlata was my oldest sister. Ida was 2 years older than I am, and her name was I-D-A, Ida. And I was the third daughter in the family. 3.5 years later, we had an addition to this family, and again another little girl, and my father was very proud, having four daughters, and her name was Genya, G-E-N-Y-A, probably that would be spelled in English. Mm-hmm. It was a very, very happy family with very, very young parents. A Friday before Shabbat, my father used to close up the store. We had our own store, a butchery, mm-hmm. and close up, and mother had all the most delicious foods already smelling. Before I used to come home in the streets, I already smelled her fish and baking her own challah. And the candles were prepared on the table. They were lighting candles. My father used to make kiddush and go to shul. And Saturdays, it was absolutely no driving, no going nowhere. It was a full Saturday observance, very religiously. In 1939, our parents started to tell us that something is happening terribly in between the Germans and the Russians. And what I understood at that point is there is a war. It didn't bother me because the war wasn't in my house. It wasn't in our country. What do I have to do with the war? We were taken through the woods all the way to Kovno. They brought us into our city. My oldest sister came to pick me up. Running through the streets until we got to our house was an unbelievable experience because bombs kept on falling in the streets too. And it was a non-stop violent bombing. So by the time we came home, my mother and father were completely destroyed, not knowing what's happening with us until we got, because there were no telephone communications in those days, and we didn't even have a telephone in the house. But we finally got together, and the family was together. And they tried to explain to me that this is the war. So what are we going to do about it? Well, we'll have to try to run away, because if this is what's happening, the Germans will come here, and they will do to us the same thing what they did to the Polish people in Poland. The second morning, we were all packed up, little packages my mother put together, some food and clothing, and we started to go on the road trying to escape Kovno as far as we could. The direction was towards the Russian border. So we were just like moving on foot because we didn't have anything else. We had a couple of bicycles with us, and that's all we had.
Were there other people running away?
Thousands. Somebody came ahead of us telling us there's no use to go any further because the Germans are already ahead of us. And they are pushing us back. They're going to come and they'll push us back, going back to Kovno. There's nowhere to escape anymore because the Russian border was still too far from us. So we turn around and we start heading back home. There were right away, I must say, Lithuanian police, were they, and Germans, that they were already like brothers and sisters and helped each other right away what to do. What do we do now with the Jews? So they separated the men from the women. We stayed there for a week. We were hardly given any food. There was nowhere to wash. There was nowhere to... any facilities of bathrooms.
No bathrooms.
They let us go only in a place where it was a big hole, and you just went there to whatever you had to do. No water. And if this wasn't enough, almost every night, Germans and Lithuanians used to come in and take out women, younger women, rape them, sometimes throw them back, and sometimes you never saw them again. And that was for 7 nights, 7 days and 7 nights that we struggled there to be together and hide each other. My mother was constantly sleeping over my oldest sister. To cover her, they shouldn't see her. And this is how she escaped from that disaster, not to be raped there. What happened to the man, we didn't know at this point. Until the seventh day, they told us to go home. We could all go home because they're going to open up a ghetto and we're going to be all put into a ghetto, so they don't need us there anymore.
Was this a closed ghetto?
It was closed up with wires all around us. And there were Lithuanians and German, Lithuanian police and German army always watching us. We couldn't have big and wide apartments or homes. So they pushed us in, sometimes two or three families in one house. My parents found a tiny little house for the six of us. And right away, the first week came, they call it Aktias, action, but we call it Aktia. Immediately, they came, the Germans, with big trucks, and we had to give away a lot of our belongings, anything that had any value. So every day was another story. One day they came and took away from us all our electrical appliances. Another time they came and took away anything that had a value of silver, gold, money, watches, anything that had value, all the jewelry, you had to give it away. Then they started to clear out the ghetto with people. So by 500 people in one time, 1,000 people another time, every couple of weeks something was happening. And it became shorter, smaller and smaller, the population. Then they told where we lived, they asked us to move in deeper into the middle of the area because not too many people were left already, so they kept on making smaller the ghetto. Meanwhile, we were still together, and it was a very unusual thing because they didn't touch any of us yet. So we were the four daughters, my father and my mother together. Until that big disastrous day, they asked the whole ghetto people get out of their homes. There are many Germans and Lithuanians, and they start making groups. Every family stood together and lined up like that. You kept on coming closer to the Germans' line, And they told you, you go to the left, and this goes to the right. And this is how they segregated us. When it came to our line, my grandmother was sent to one side, but our family was sent to the, all of us together, to the other side. So we are, now we're still together, but my grandmother was the first one to go. When they did that, certain, that area, which was the left side, they told us all to go back to our homes. And the other side of people, we saw that they were taken away out of the ghetto. And when we noticed where they are going, we knew they are taking them to a place called the Ninth Fort. Late at night, we heard a lot of shooting. And there were 9,200 people shot in one night and burned to death. That broke down the ghetto in the most horrible way. So we lived in one room. My whole family was, we had just one room. And they tried to explain to us what this is all about. We have to stick together, and whatever it will happen, we will try to die together so none of us should be left alone. But this is the only dream that we had. If we have to die, that we should die together. We should not be left without each other. People, since it was already a year and a half passed by, and people started to get used to the disastrous life, and believe it or not, you could find young people getting married in the ghetto. Women had children. Some evenings we used to have fun too, being that I had two older sisters, and they had friends. So we used to get together in our house, in that little room that we lived, all of us together. And many evenings we used to sing and make ourselves happy the best way we could, and joke on our own lives, and cry together. And our home was still, again, all the time, full of people and full of young people. I would say that the worst impact of life to me personally was the day that they came to take all the children away from the ghetto. That was an action that destroyed, actually, me at this point, because I have seen how they did it and what they did with these kids. They came in with trucks and dogs, big German Shepherd dogs, and they went from house to house and screamed, whoever has little kids, to come outside. And they didn't take the mother and the child together. They just tore out the baby, or a child of 4 or 5 or 10. If a mother didn't give that baby away freely, so they let the dogs on that woman, and the dog would tear her apart until she would leave, of course, the baby off her hands, and then they used to take the baby and throw it in. Just actually throwing it into the trucks. Some of them took the babies by their legs and just beating them through the walls into the truck. It was just hard to describe what that was going on there. They came to our house. My little sister was at this point only 8 years old. We tried to hide her. So she was under the bed, big hiding. She was laying there under the bed and said, not to say a word, we don't want to hear nothing out of you. And the Germans came in and started with, children, where are the children? Do you have any children? And he said, no, 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 no. And he just turned his head down and he said, he saw my little sister there. This is not a child, come out here. And she came out and she started crying and tearing his clothes off him. Please don't take me. Please don't take me.
I will work, I'll do everything I can, just don't take me away from my mother and father. And she was tearing him, his clothes, and climbing on him. And he gave her like a shove off from him. What the hell do you think you're doing here on top of me? The moment she fell off him, I grabbed her by hand and we ran to the back door, and I didn't come back with her again. And she was saved at this moment. At this moment she was saved. They walked out. It was a miracle from a second. I don't know what the German felt at this moment. He got tired of her or whatever, and he walked out. We saved our little sister. But what was going on in the streets, that's the worst that anybody could bear to watch it. They started to clear out the ghetto. Many of the families, if there were families left or singles, tried to hide. And we in our room did have a basement, but with so many people that came to ask us to be together with, if because they didn't have where to hide, if they could stay with us. So everybody that asked us, we stayed with them, okay. And we were laying there. My Ida, my middle sister, had trouble with her sinuses. So they crawled out of our basement, asking our cousins if they wouldn't mind to keep my sister there, because they were not as packed there as in our room. And my sister was left there. The morning that she moved out from our basement to the other house, the Germans came in and they started to clear out every house. From house to house they went to see if somebody's left there, because they're evacuating us. So they screamed out, anybody in the house, anybody in the house, because if you're not going to get out of here, we will blow the house up, which they did. My father, at this point, when they came into our house and they screamed, if you're not going to get out, if you're hiding somewhere, we will blow up the house. So my father at this point decided we are not going to be blown up or be burned to death. At least from a bullet, he said to all of us, it's going to be easier to die. Then let's get out of here. While we were walking to that place, just getting out of our house, of course our house was bombed immediately and went on fire. We could not even alert the people in the back, that little house that where my sister was, because with our house, the other one was burned too, because they were very close to each other. And so my sister and the rest of the family, cousins, wherever they were there, were burned to death. My mother kept on holding me around and said, don't look. And You could not see it because it was all around you. They asked everybody to get out. And at this point, they asked all the men to go on a side and the women should go back to the trains. And this is when all the men were taken away from us, and my father among them. And the last look on his face, saying, we will meet again, and don't worry, I'll be okay, just keep yourself alive, and we'll meet again. And that was the last time I saw him. Where he was taken at this point, we didn't know. But we wind up in this concentration camp that is called Stutthof. That's what they brought us in. What we had to do is get undressed, leave all our clothes right next to us, completely naked, go into a place where it was a shower. We were throwing over us water. Go out to another side. And there they gave us different clothing, whatever you could grab, a pair of shoes, a skirt, a dress, whatever. But it was not ours. Whatever was left there, that wasn't ours. And they assigned on each one of us a number, not tattooed, but just with a pencil, that we at least we should know our number. 5429. And then they sent us into the barracks. And we stayed there that night. The second day, they asked us, all of us, to get out of the barracks and line up and start choosing. Some children were still with us. Children meaning not anymore younger than 8, 9, mm-hmm. which my little sister was. And every mother with a little girl like that was put on another line. Knowing that it is going to be taken away from me, I asked the German, can I come along? And he said, no. And I said, but I want to go together with my mother and my sister. And he said, no, you cannot. But I said, I do want to be with them. So he gave me he had a stick in his hand, and he gave me over my head. I probably lost my conscience. But when I woke up from it, with a lot of my friends around me, they weren't there anymore. Which took me probably over a year and a half later to find out what really happened to them. They were taken to Auschwitz, to the crematoriums. That was the end of my family starting to fall apart. At this point, I was left only with my sister in Stutthof, not even being together with her closely. I knew she was there because she was in different wagons that when we were brought into Stutthof. We lost each other's places, and we lost each other. We didn't know where she was. She didn't know where I was. Different barracks, different places, and we lost each other. So actually, I was left alone. How long can one live on one slice of bread and a little bit of water? People started to die of starvation. People started to get very sick, and there was no help, medical help, so they just shoot you when they notice that the person cannot work anymore. And the camp started to get smaller and smaller. And one day, when I felt I am at the end of my strength, hardly walking out from the camp, going to work, I decided I'm going to do just like somebody else did, is try to escape and run into a house, maybe beg for something. And when I noticed that a German wasn't watching me, I did. And I came into a house, and I asked them, just leave me. I'm not asking for anything. Just let me sit here and warm. Don't give me anything. I don't want anything. Just let me sit here. And they did. And they really didn't give me nothing, not a piece of bread or a bite of bread. Just let me sit there. And in the warm, I felt like I'm back to the world that I haven't seen for years now. Going back, it was time to go back because I had to go back to camp. I did not watch so carefully, and the German noticed me. So he ran over seeing me coming from the outside. And he beat me up on my back. I got 25 bad lashes over my back. And during the night, I picked myself up a little bit, and I said, if this was going to happen to me, I'm going to do that tomorrow again, but he's not going to catch me again. Sure enough, on the second morning, we walked out to the place. I escaped again, and I came into a house, and I said to them, I'm hungry, and I'm barefoot, and I cannot continue working to make the Germans happy. Can you just help me with some food, and I'll do everything you want me into this house. Just let me stay with you. I'll feed your cows, and I'll feed your pigs, and I'll wash your floors. I'll sew it for you. I'll do anything. Just let me stay with you. And they did. And I was working there a full day, and every potato I threw into the cows or to the pigs, the second potato was in my mouth. I filled myself up with so much of it. I cannot tell you how many. And packed my pockets full of them. By the time I had the evening, I had to go back, made sure, first of all, that the German will not see me. But I had even in my pockets some potatoes I could give my friends. And I did it every day for 2 weeks. That picked me up to have the death road that we had to go right after that. Because one morning we woke up and they didn't take us to work, but we had to escape from the Russians, that they were starting to come closer to us.
When was this?
That was already in the early days of January 1945.
Okay. Still bitter winter.
Bad winter. I was ashamed that my stomach was full, because they died on the roads, from starvation, from cold. And if they fell fainting, so the German killed them right there and then. They wouldn't let us carry them. One evening, they took us into to the woods, the Germans, and they said, listen, your time has just come. We leave you here. We cannot stay with you anymore. We leave you here, and you do whatever you want to do. What could have been done? Nobody had the strength to do, and nobody knew where we are. So we stayed there, and early in the morning, the Russians came there. The first Russian that I saw on a beautiful horse. And if I tell you the couple of hundred people that were left, everybody falling on the floor, kissing the horse's legs, and the Russian, and screaming out of hysterics, thanking them for coming for our liberation. That's a picture that I will never in my life get out of my mind. Never. I turn around and I said to myself, so what good is it? Where's my mother? Where's my father? Where are my sisters? So what am I here now, left alive? I don't even know if my family is alive. So who wants to live? I really had no need for it. Life was not important to me at this point anymore. We found each other. She was without hair. She had typhoid. And to see each other all over again was probably the most beautiful moment of my life.
Who was in this picture?
This is my full family. In 1932, full family portrait. My mother all the way in the middle and the top. Father right next to her on the right. My oldest sister on her left. Grandma holding on her lap my little sister, Genya. In the middle is Ida. And myself sitting right on my father's lap. A child of three. I want to dedicate this taping to my daughter Edith Schneerson and to all the future generations that will come. They should know and never forget. what Hitler did to me, to my family, and to 6 million Jews. That's all I have to ask. And I'll be the happiest if they will.